Simon Bates. Love life, love music. Smooth radio.
Now, I'm going to get myself in trouble with this one because I don't fully understand it, and I'll probably say the wrong thing, and people will object. But I think the first thing is where we're coming from on this is that neither Seb nor I have cerebral palsy, and we don't know anybody who's got cerebral palsy. And so, therefore, while we sympathise with it, we will probably get some of the details. I will probably get some of the details wrong. Please do not be offended. Because this is a real story from Paul, and it's a real story about real people. And therefore, inevitably, if I slip up and make the wrong politically correct statement or something, it's not intentional. It's just part of the game. Goes back to 2007. Paul is disabled with cerebral palsy. He spends his time in a wheelchair, lives in Northumberland. To explain how bad the palsy is, his body makes movements sometimes, which he doesn't want it to do. It's involuntary, and that has limited his life enormously. However, he works really hard at what he is and who he is. Even though he's in a wheelchair, he spends a lot of time on the internet. Social networking has enabled him to talk and to meet people. He can't nip down to the pub on his own to have a drink. He can't meet people and make new friends under those circumstances. And the internet has been a lifesaver. One afternoon, he was looking at people's photographs. One of them was titled A Breath of Fresh Air, and that was her. Her name was Kitty, and he decided to send her an email. She replied, and they talked almost every day. Bear in mind that there is another issue with Paul's cerebral palsy, and that is sometimes he presses buttons he doesn't want to because of his body movement, and therefore sometimes his spelling is a bit eccentric. She replied. They talked almost every day. They talked about everything. They talked about anything, and they got to know each other well. And one thing that Paul liked about her is that she wasn't embarrassed. She asked him about his disability. He tried to be as honest as possible, and there were no secrets, therefore. They talked for months, and then something silly, and they fell out. And she closed her account, but Paul was very fond of her. That's it, fond of her. Never stopped thinking about her. She was in his thoughts most days, not because he fancied her. He just missed the chats, the intimacy. And he loved the fact they could talk about anything without being embarrassed. So, about a year later, he put her name in the available column. And just to see if she was back on, and couldn't believe, there she was. The photograph came up. He looked at her photograph for 3 or 4 minutes, thinking, will I send an email just to say hi, how are you? Or will that cause embarrassment? And after a bit, he did, and he forgot it. And he thought after 3 or 4 weeks, well, that's her choice. I won't hear from her again. Until a few weeks later, he got an email from Kitty saying, sorry, it took so long to reply, and sorry about the misunderstanding. And they went back to talking all the time, and getting on better than the year before. In February 2009, Paul and his mum went down to London for the weekend, and he told Kitty they were going down, and shall we meet? And Kitty said, yeah. So they spent the Sunday afternoon together and had a great time, a terrific time. They talked, they had a good laugh, and one thing that she said was that she felt comfortable being around him, and she'd been worried about that. What she never knows, and never will know, is how much he learnt from her that one afternoon. He learnt about social communication in a different way to the way that people have been helping him. He learnt to stand up for himself, literally, and to be aware of his posture and to make his posture better. There's another story about it, which involves a dog that he got from Dogs for the Disabled, but that is another story, and a story we might feature at some stage in the future. They had a great meal. Kitty bought that. Lovely afternoon. She sent a text when she got home saying how much she enjoyed the afternoon and would love to meet up again. 2 or 3 weeks went by, And he noticed that she went a bit cold on him on the net, and he thought it was a bit odd. And then she sent an email saying, sorry about being standoffish, but she was busy at work and things would get back to normal soon. Meantime, he got a new mobile phone. And this is where you realise how difficult life is for other people and not for the likes of you and me. Because his body makes these involuntary movements, which he doesn't want it to, he kept pressing buttons on the mobile phone, which he didn't mean to press. And the phone kept dialing Kitty's number. She thought that he was doing it on repeat recall and got a bit cross. And Paul says in his letter that he'd get cross if someone phoned him all the time. She was explained to her what was happening, and she understood, and the weeks went by, and they talked less and less, and in the end they stopped talking to each other. The problem was that Kitty thought that Paul was in love with her, and she was afraid of that. But she was wrong. He was fond of her, and that's very different. It's sad because she would have made a good friend, and he wanted her as a friend. And after 3 years not talking to her, he still misses talking to her online. And if she's listening to this, maybe Paul hasn't made it clearly straightforward enough that he's not in love, he's just deeply fond of you. So, the story and the tune is by Lindisfarne, and there is a line in the song which says pretty much everything that I think Paul is trying to say to Kitty. I will do anything you want me to. We just don't get on because the change has passed me by.
If I seem kind of blue to you, it's just 'cause I'm not getting through to you. And I'll do anything you want me to, just so we can get along. And if I should have a mind to say, what is it makes you want to be this way? Could be today's just not my lucky day, and I can't do right for doing wrong. I've told you what you mean to me, I've even told you what you've been to me. I wish we could be where we both belong, but I can't do right for doing wrong. I say too little or I say too much, I see no recognition in your eye. I try to fix it with a tender touch, but I see too late, the chance has passed me by. Sometimes when I don't have much time to stay, I'll make a move and watch you turn away. I'll hesitate when I should come on strong, but I can't do right for doing wrong. But I see too late, the chance has passed me by. We could get to where we want to be with just a little faith and honesty, instead of drifting where we don't belong. But I can't do right for can't do right for doing wrong. Can't do right for doing wrong.
That's Lindisfarne, Can't Do Right for Doing Wrong. And I knew I'd get something wrong on this, and of course I did. Thank you very much indeed from Glasgow, Nurse Marie. Cerebral palsy is not pronounced cerebral. That's the American pronunciation. And you are absolutely right. And I don't know why I did that, because I really hate it when I get things wrong like that. And it's so obvious. Cerebral palsy is the American... Cerebral palsy, rather, is the American pronunciation. Paul, I'm really sorry, and anybody else I've offended. This is about isolation, isn't it? It's about someone who's having to deal with something, which is pretty tough. And is dealing with it well, and is suffering from cerebral palsy. And wouldn't it be great if Kitty said hi? Just hi, nothing else.